아, 안녕히 계세요. 안녕하세요. I have been many, many times in Korea in the last 30 years. The first time I came here was for the Olympic Games. Some of you were not born at the time of the Olympic Games. And I thought Korea is such a fascinating country that I have come many, many times, and with my friend Park Myung-soo, many more times recently. Okay, so actually, I have even published books in Korea with my friend Park Myung-soo, and I have traveled extensively in Korea, and I have had Korean students. The first Korean astronaut was one of my students in California, and I also have gone to North Korea. So I have visited the dark side of Korea. Okay, so I work with the Millennium Project, which is a futuristic part of the United Nations University, even though today it's an independent NGO looking at the future, and we publish books about the future, like The State of the Future, and I coordinated a book about Latin America, which is where I was born in Latin America, and what is happening in the year 2030. I presented that book at the World Economic Forum that was in Switzerland, and I met Donald Trump at the time, and I made a TV program with him talking about the future. Okay, so I am interested in development. The first country in human history that doubled its income per capita was the United Kingdom during the Industrial Revolution. And it was between 1780 and 1838. That means it took 58 years for the first country in the history of humanity to double its income. Then many, many other countries have done that faster, like South Korea in 10, 11 years, but now the world record is China. So this is happening faster and faster. Okay, but this began in the 18th century. Until the 18th century, humanity was caught in what is called the Malthusian trap. Robert Malthus was a British economist that in the 18th century, he said that humanity was condemned, because there were too many people and there were not enough resources. Fortunately, he was wrong, and the Industrial Revolution began. In the 19th century, humanity grew 100%. In the 20th century, humanity grew, in economic terms, 400%. And in this 21st century, humanity will grow 2,000% or 3,000%. We are living in incredible times. This is the best time to be alive. In the next 20 years, we are going to see more changes than in the last 2,000 years. I repeat, in the next two decades, more changes than in the last two millennia. But there will be groups that will oppose technology, like the Amish. The Amish are groups who want to live in the 18th century, or in Latin America or in Africa, there were groups that didn't want the wheels. They were anti-wheels groups. So there will always be groups against technology. Some of the most famous are called the Luddites. The Luddites, 2 centuries ago in England, during the Industrial Revolution, they began destroying machines because they said that the machines would take away our jobs, human jobs. Fortunately, again, they were wrong, both the Luddites and the anti-wheels and the Amish. And that is why humanity has progress, because technology is good. Almost 10 years ago, a new university was created in California. I am one of the founders of Singularity University 2008-2009. And this is a very special university that has the wrong name. And it has the wrong name not once, but twice. First, because it is not a university. And second, because it is not about the singularity. Singularity University is basically an incubator of ideas, an accelerator of business. So it is not a university, and it is not just about the singularity. Okay, the idea of the singularity is that we will soon reach artificial intelligence equivalent to human intelligence. And this will happen before the year 2045 at the latest. So the technological singularity will change humanity. And one of the consequences, as you can see in the subtitle, is the year man becomes immortal. But for the ladies here, no problem. Ladies, women will also become immortal. The idea of the singularity was popularized by Ray Kurzweil, who is an engineer of MIT, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, which is also my alma mater. And he talks how technology is doubling every 2 years. And if this trend continues, between 2029 and 2045, we will reach the technological singularity, when artificial intelligence is equivalent to human intelligence. And you can measure that comparing the number of neurons that you have in the brain with the number of transistors that computers have. So when we have computers with many transistors equal to the neurons in the brain, we will reach the technological singularity. And so that you do not sleep tonight, that will be the end of the human age. The end of the human age. Because once we have an artificial intelligence higher than human intelligence, there is nothing that any of you or me will do before the artificial intelligence, unless we merge with the artificial intelligence. And that is what will happen. We will fuse with the artificial intelligence. Okay, so you can see the changes. I just wanted to show you, because 30 years ago, I used this. These were computer memories 30 years ago, before most of you were born. Basically, this is 10 times 100, which makes 1,000. This is 1K of memory. And I used this 30 years ago. But you could not change it. And therefore, the first electromagnetic memories were created. And you have another example here. I used this 30 years ago. This was also 1K. But this 1K was better because you could erase. And then more memories came, as you probably know. I have another example. This you might have seen. This was 512K. And here, how much was this? How much? 1.4 mega. And then I have an example of a flash drive here from the World Economic Forum of 128 gigabytes. So I want you to think about this. In the last 30 years, we have moved from 1K to 128 gigabytes. Let me ask you, what do you think will happen in the next 30 years? In the next 30 years, we will reach a level superior to the human brain. And that is the technological singularity, when artificial intelligence reaches human intelligence level. So this is happening with all technologies, also with biotechnology and medicine. Let me show you my human genome. I will show you the partial sequence of my genome so that you do not know everything completely about me. But if you look at this, this is my name, this is Jose Cordeiro, and there is this company, many companies actually sequence the genome. But this is one with little devices like this. This is called a gene chip, a chip for the genes. Once you sequence your genome, you will know which diseases you will have. What is the probability of you having Parkinson's, having Alzheimer's? After you sequence your genome, you will know what you will die of. Isn't that interesting? To know what you will die of? Yes. But, so that you do not die of that, because in the future, medicine will not be curative. Medicine will be preventive. And we will prevent all diseases in the future. You will also know where you come from. This is my paternal line in the last few centuries. You can see from Spain all the way to Asia, mostly Mongolia, and some famous people related to my father, like Genghis Khan. So no one wants to fight here with me.
Yeah.
So that's my paternal line. I'll show you now my maternal line. And you can see on my mother's side, I come from Maria Antonieta. I come from a very aristocratic family between Genghis Khan and Maria Antonieta. All of you will know where you come from after you sequence your genome, and you will know your ancestors, and you will be able to recreate your genealogical tree, and for the first time, you will verify if your father is really your father. Actually, you are part of the last human generation that has not been designed. In the future, we will design our children. All of you are here by mistake. You are an error. You were not designed. In the future, we will design our children. Like in this experiment I did with one of my students, we share genes. This is a theoretical experiment to see how our children would be. And you choose the genes that you want. We will design the future human generations. The Human Genome Project began in 1990, and it finished in 2003, which means 30 years, and it cost over $1 billion. Today, in 2017, you can sequence your genome for less than $900 in 3 days. And we expect that by 2025, you will sequence your complete genome for $10 in 1 minute. This is incredibly exponential, both in cost from $1 billion to $10, and in time from 30 years to 1 minute. This is happening with all technologies that are changing exponentially, and things are becoming faster, smaller, cheaper, and better. However, we do not understand exponential change because we think linearly. But there is a big difference between linear and exponential. For example, if I walk linearly and I did 30 steps, after 30 steps of 1 meter each, I have walked 30 meters. But if I walk exponentially and I double, after 30 doublings, I have walked over 1 billion meters and I have gone around planet Earth 26 times. But we don't understand this because we think, our brains think linearly, but technology changes exponentially. We think about the future in 4 ways. The worst way is to be passive, like an ostrich, that you just suffer the future, you hide yourself. Much better is to be reactive, like a firefighter when there is a fire. But much better is to be preactive when you buy insurance to prepare yourself. But the best possible way is to be proactive. You can create the future. You can build the future you want. So you have to think and be proactive about the future. So I hope we do not have ostriches here, because ostriches are not Korean. But if we have ostriches, they should be technological ostriches. 10 years ago, I went to visit one of the most famous science fiction writers in history, Sir Arthur C. Clarke, who wrote many books and movies like The Space Odyssey 2001. But he's also very famous because he wrote the 3 laws of the future, which are very important. First law of the future. When a famous scientist says that something is possible, he's probably right. But when he says it is impossible, he's probably wrong. Second law. The only way of discovering the limits of the future is to venture past those limits into the impossible. And the third law, any sufficiently advanced technology is indistinguishable from magic. And so the future will be magic. So, 30 years there were no computers. 20 years mobile phones were beginning. 10 years ago, Google, Facebook were growing. So in the future, we're going to see magical technologies. One of those will be medicine. What is happening in medicine? We are changing the whole world of medicine. We are having medicine which is interactive and proactive. Okay, so we have many disruptions in all technologies. As you probably know, the cases of Uber, that is the largest taxi company in the world, but it has no taxis. or Facebook, the largest media company, or Alibaba, the largest retailer, or Airbnb, the largest hotel chain with no rooms. So at Singularity University, we learn exponential technologies during 3 months. The first month, we find the curriculum. The second month, we have company visits and convergence of technologies. And the last month is team projects to have startup companies. And we have had many, many startup companies in different areas. So every year we have like 10 incredible companies in different areas, in medicine, space, infotechnology, nanotechnology, etc. And they are really incredible in different areas. This one, for example, is called Matternet, using drones for transportation of medicine and food. Yeah. And another one is Made in Space, that is printing in space in the International Space Station. And another one that I love is Growing Plants. Growing Plants, that was financed with, they had over $300,000, and in 1 month they had $500,000 to make Growing Plants. But they began using a very interesting plant in California, which is marijuana. Marijuana is very common in California, and if it grows, it is better. So 2 more minutes to talk about some of the technologies of the future quickly. One is we are going to go into space. In 10 years, there are companies, private companies, and startup companies thinking about going to Mars. So this is what is going to happen. We will be colonizing space. But the other sector, which is fundamental, is medicine. And we consider that aging is a disease, but it is a curable disease. And there are many companies right now working on curing aging. So actually, for the young people here, you form part of the first immortal human generation. If you have less than 30 years, it is almost sure that you might be immortal if you behave well. In the last 10 years, we have been able to increase the life of mice 3 times. We have mice today who live the equivalent of 300 human years. And we have mosquitoes that live 4 times and worms that live 6 times. This is only the beginning. We are very soon have immortal mice, immortal mosquitoes, and immortal humans. Actually, some people think this is impossible. Well, I'll tell you, it is possible because cancer cells are mutant cells that do not age. Cancer cells are biologically immortal. And let me ask you, how many of you knew that cancer cells do not age, that cancer cells are biologically immortal? This is important because the proof that immortality is possible is that it already exists. It already happens in biology. Cancer cells do not age. And I will show you one more thing, which I think is important, because we will cure aging. We will stop aging. But people will still die in the next few years. So just simply, I want to, while companies like Google will try to solve death, and then Microsoft will try to cure cancer in 10 years, and Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook is donating all his money, all his fortune, to cure all diseases in 1 generation. So in the next 20 to 30 years, we will cure all diseases. We'll even rejuvenate people. In 30 years, I will be younger than today because we are going to rejuvenate people. I will not be older in 30 years. I will be younger, but people will still die. And if you die in the next 30 years, we have Plan B. Plan B is cryopreservation. And he was in charge of cryopreserving the first person in Spain. This is a technology that is only beginning. And we believe that if anyone dies in the next few years, we can freeze them. We can priorly suspend the person and reanimate them in the future. But that's Plan B. Plan A is not to die. So I hope you do not die in the next 20 to 30 years. But if you die, I can freeze you. Thank you.